Coming up on this week's episode of TechSNAP, a Google Talk outage this morning took out Gmail and a bunch of other Google-related services and even resulted in Twitter going down. We've got the details. Plus, how to determine if your WordPress site has been hacked and some crazy new malware software for the Mac. And then we've got a whole batch of audience questions and our answers. That's all coming up on this week's episode of TechSNAP. Hi, everyone, and welcome to TechSNAP. This is episode 68 of Jupiter Broadcasting's weekly systems network and administration podcast. We recorded this episode live on July 26, 2012. This episode is brought to you by GoDaddy.com, and the live stream is powered by the incredible ScaleEngine.com. I'm sure we'll be telling you about both of those things as the show goes on. My name is Chris, and joining us like every single week is our host, the tech, the admin, and the teacher, Alan Jute. Hey, Alan.
Hey, Chris, everybody. Thanks for watching.
Hey, man. Welcome back to TechSNAP. I'm excited. We're getting close to episode 70. That seems like a big accomplishment. And like every single week, you have prepared a master show. How many pages are the show notes this week?
Like four or five pages?
Okay. All right. Probably. And then when you actually, you know, break it all down, it's a beautiful thing. So be sure you hit the show notes this week because we have got a lot to cover. And while you're over at Jupiter Broadcasting, please consider using our affiliate links. In fact, please consider checking your Chrome extension. Now, you know, over at JupiterBroadcasting.com, we have the affiliate links at the bottom of the website where you click on one of those before you shop, and then a portion of your shopping session is contributed to Jupiter Broadcasting. And we just added Netflix. And what's been awesome is we've had this Chrome extension that folks can use. However, Chrome does automatic updates in the background. It doesn't even tell you about that. And one of the things they've introduced is automatically disabling extensions that didn't come from the Chrome Web Store. And that resulted in us seeing a $1,000 drop in our revenue last month, which meant that I had to put $2,000 in out of pocket. I usually put about $1,000 in to keep the network afloat. And I don't have the funds to do that. So I'm imploring everyone to go, please check your Chrome extensions. They've been disabled, but it's really easy. If you go into your Chrome settings and then extensions and you scroll down, you'll see right there, you can see mine's been disabled because of the update. So if I just check the enable box, there we go. Now my extensions turn back on and the shopping sessions will be tagged. So please, if everyone has some time to check that, help us keep things on the air because we really can't literally go through. The network cannot go through another month like that. And we'll have to do some sort of drastic changes. So please go check those out. Also, while you're over there, another way to just guarantee that we can stay on the air is just by contributing directly over JupiterBroadcasting.com/donate. We have options now for an Amazon $7 a month and $10 a month, and then the PayPal links. I hate to say this, but it really is coming down to this with the affiliate donation drop-off. Maybe we'll see things turn around as people get the message and they get the latest batch of shows and they learn about the extension issue. It might just improve itself, but we never really know, and things are getting critical, so I'm putting the word out there. All right, Alan, so my piece has been said. And also, you know, if you don't have Netflix yet and you want to help us, another way you could do that is to use the new Netflix affiliate link we have down there. Yep. But unfortunately, Alan, it is U.S. only. Right. I apologize. Now, you have a great show, so we should get into it. Enough with all of the bad news. Let's get into other people's problems, stuff that doesn't really affect me, at least hopefully, because I slept through the Google Talk outage this morning, but I guess they had a pretty decent outage, didn't they?
Yes. This morning at 6:40 a.m. Eastern, which is 10:40 a.m. UTC, but is only 3:40 a.m. Chris time, Google Talk experienced an outage for basically all users. Users were able to access Google Talk, but they would just receive an error and not actually be able to communicate via text or voice with other people. This interrupted a lot of business users who use Google Apps, and they have their, you know, Google Docs, Google Calendar, Gmail on their own domain, and the Google Talk for messaging and voice calls. And so it was down all morning. Google finally reported the issue as being resolved at 11:25 Eastern or 15:25 UTC, but you know that's only 8:30 a.m. for Chris, and so most businesses on the West Coast probably, you know, it was repaired before they started business.
That's good.
But on the East Coast, it was quite the interruption.
Well, and Google's headquarters are on the West Coast, so I wonder if that played a little bit into the timing of things. I'm sure they had people working around the clock.
Some Google engineer was working at 3:30 in the morning.
Wow.
Through to 6:30 in the morning. Google hasn't released any details about what caused the problem or what they had to do to fix it. But a large number of users took to Twitter to complain about the outage. And then shortly after, Twitter had its own outage, possibly even caused by the increased traffic generated by the Google outage. In what we like to call the cascade of fail.
Yeah, no kidding, right? Everybody probably went to go tweet. Oh my gosh, Google's down, Google's down.
Yes, or like, I can't use Google because of this or that.
And, man, that's funny.
So much traffic on Twitter that Twitter suffered its own.
You know,
problems.
A website gets a lot of traffic or a server gets a lot of traffic that when it goes down, it causes other services to go down because people are just talking about it. Now that's like, wow.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of, you know, every time there's a major news event and all the news websites can't handle the load.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Which we've talked about.
Yep.
So not really too bad for people on the West Coast, but the East Coast people really got burned.
But it really shows that what happens when you depend on the cloud to provide services that are integral to your business.
Yeah, and you know, Google really has a pretty good track record, so you don't really think
And you know, at the same time, if this had been an internal messaging system and it had suffered the same failure, the IT department for your business probably wouldn't have turned it around as quickly and got it back up as quickly.
Potentially, yeah. Let's be honest. There's a very good case that's true.
You know, if you had your own control over it, at least maybe they could have done something different.
Yeah. Well, all right. Why don't we talk about a little bit of Mac news? Now, of course... Mountain Lion just shipped yesterday, the Mountain Lion. We're not actually talking about that. However, I did upgrade one of my Macs that I have here in the production chain. And so far, it was pretty smooth. I downloaded it from the App Store. It expanded and it upgraded, and pretty much everything's totally fine. It broke my Quicksilver app, and it also broke my soundboard that I use for Unfilter and Coda Radio, which that means tonight's Unfilter is going to be a little touch and go. and go figure, I have the most sound clips I have ever had for any episode of Unfiltered tonight, so hopefully it stays together. But that's not actually what this story is about, is it? This is about some malware for the Mac.
Yes, this is a drive-by malware. The main difference here is that you get it by going to a website or whatever without having to do any user interaction, so you don't have to say yes to some prompt or click on anything. It just happens silently in the background without you knowing.
That sounds like an Internet Explorer trick.
Yeah. And basically, it installs silently and doesn't require any user interaction. The malware is also intelligent in that it detects whether you're running as an admin user or a regular user. And if you're an admin user and you actually have the privileges, it will install a rootkit that will actually hide the existence of the malware.
Wow. This is
And
this
if you're a regular user, then it just... Basically, if you're a regular user, it installs 14 files. And if you're an admin user, it installs 17 files and hides itself.
And it does it all without any user interaction. So because one of the things people always said on the Mac is, well, before something can do something with administrative level privileges, it has to come up and prompt you.
The password.
Yeah.
And in this one, somehow it gets around that.
Now, I wonder, I suppose, one of the features they've added in Mountain Lion is by default, in order for apps to run, they have to be signed by Apple. So that might in Mountain Lion be a solution, but which just came out yesterday. So the other, you know, Lion and Snow Leopard or whatever, they would still be vulnerable to this.
Yes. In the article, which is a couple days old now, they talk about how they don't know how this will affect the new version, if the malware will work on the new version, or if, you know, a lot of the apps that people use will even work on the new version, you know.
I find it interesting, too. They say that it spies on you via Adium, which is the most popular instant messenger client for the Mac.
But also Firefox, Safari, and Skype as well.
This is like a full-fledged Windows malware. This is like...
And once installed, the malware also phones home to a server in the UK. It appears to be running at Linode, which is a cloud hosting provider. Now, I would expect that node will get shut down or already has been shut down, but... The idea there would be that it receives further instructions or participates in a botnet, which, you know, botnets typically do things like sending spam, clicking on ads run by the spammer, generating revenue, basically.
Yeah. oh my gosh.
Or scanning and infecting other computers or websites.
Now, this is interesting because I think now Mac users can finally say they can do everything Windows users can do. So they finally get that feature parity.
Because another thing they noted is it was one of the first Mac Trojans so far that contained a lot of obfuscation and attempts to make it hard to reverse engineer the virus. to figure out how it works. And that's something that wasn't very common on Mac malware up to this point.
Yeah, absolutely.
But you know, with it targeting Firefox, Safari, Adium, and Skype, it seems that the goal there would be to steal passwords or other keystrokes. You know, get your username and password for stuff to steal. Also, spreading to other Mac users via instant messaging, right? Adium and Skype. If you get a file transfer from someone on your Adium or Skype, you're more likely to accept and run that file than if it was from some random person.
Absolutely.
And it's basically a form of social engineering. It's basically by impersonating a real user on your contact list, you send them this virus. The article doesn't actually talk about how this malware gets on your system, so I don't know if something like NoScript would help, but I doubt it. This is not a JavaScript type thing.
Right, right. And again, you said they can just get it by browsing a website?
Yeah. Basically, there's no user interaction required, so I don't know if that means that,
I wonder how that works.
Have to actually browse a website and there's an exploit in Java or Flash or something, or if it's something that is just a remote code execution in the operating system where it can be triggered without you even visiting a website.
I'd be really curious to know because, I mean, like Safari's supposed to do some type of sandboxing. Isn't Chrome supposed to do some sort of sandboxing? Curious to know because that would be... You almost got to wonder if it is Flash, don't you? Or Java. It almost always is, isn't it?
There's very little detail in the article. I couldn't get more information on it.
Yeah.
As not a Mac user, I don't know that much about it.
Yeah. All right, Alan. Well, this next story might actually change my opinion about USB. People might not even believe it that I could actually be bigoted about something like this. But I'm actually not a big fan of USB, especially for any kind of production work. But maybe Asus is going to change my tune on that.
Yes. So Asus has released the first devices that support USB-attached SCSI protocol.
Really?
So basically, it's a way to use SCSI commands over USB to make access to external hard drives, HDDs and SDDs, or SSDs, faster.
Interesting. So they're using SCSI technology, which is a lot older than USB.
Basically, the SCSI protocol.
Over the USB.
USB. It's still USB protocol. It's just... allowing you to send the SCSI commands over it.
And this is about what? This must be letting them work around just issues that USB inherently has?
Yeah. Well, basically, USB still uses BOT, or bulk only transfer mode, which is something that was invented with USB 1 in 1998 or whenever USB was.
I believe it was 1875, actually. Yeah.
Yep. Anyway. The problem with bulk only transfer mode is that it has a high command latency, no queuing, and a lack of parallelism. So you can't have two commands running at once.
Mm.
So the USB-attached SCSI protocol allows you to have up to 64,000 commands be queued, where BOT, the standard, you can't send the next command until the command you're currently running completes. So you have to wait until the first one's acknowledged before you send the second one.
Okay.
With the SCSI one, you can queue up a whole bunch
right.
and then get the results back later. Also... USB-attached SCSI allows commands to complete out of order. So the return can happen not necessarily in the order that the commands were run in. So if you run 1234, you might get your results back as 1243. And basically, originally, that was probably done to make the chips that had to be in the USB controller simpler. If the commands always came back, if the results came back in the same order the commands went out in, and if it was only one at a time, it was a lot simpler. But now that we're trying to deal with hundreds of megabytes per second, it's just not really something that makes sense anymore.
Gotcha.
The downside to the USB-attached SCSI is it requires a specialized USB controller on both the motherboard and the USB device.
Yeah.
It doesn't require any special kind of hard drive or anything. So it's just, you know, a USB enclosure with any hard drive in it will work. But the USB enclosure and the motherboard both have to support... UASP.
And you could see why a manufacturer would want to license this technology from Asus because...
Well, no, Asus didn't invent this. This is a standard part of the USB specification. They just made the first devices for it so far.
You mean this has been around and we haven't used it?
The protocol's been defined and this is... Well, it's new, but...
Oh, okay. I was about to table flip.
Asus doesn't own this. Okay. They're just following a spec. And so other devices will come out very shortly as well.
So then we might actually see something from this.
Actually, the USB controller isn't made by Asus. It's another company.
But their boards are going to be some of the first to have it.
Yes. So they have boards that have it out now.
If you had this in, if you could do something where like the controller and the hard drive could switch between standard USB mode and the SCSI USB mode, that'd be really nice because then it'd still just be the one universal plug.
They're still backwards compatible and everything's, it just works just like that. Also, Microsoft announced that there will be a USB attached SCSI driver built into Windows 8.
Oh, well, there you go. Now I'm sold.
But even better news is that Asus has also, their devices that have it on the device side will support what's called turbo mode, which is actually an optimized version of the BOT old-fashioned USB mode. Basically what it does is it will send the next command before the first one is acknowledged.
That's
so
hardcore.
It's still, what it allows it to do is to work with existing USB controllers.
That's awesome.
It's not as fast as the USB attached SCSI, but it's faster than regular USB. So if you buy one of these Asus drive enclosures and plug it into a regular USB 3 or USB 2 port, it will be faster than a regular USB 2 device, even though your motherboard doesn't have this feature.
Now, external SSD drives could benefit from this.
Yeah. So if you have a compatible USB 3 controller like an Intel or an NEC, which is like the NEC USB 3 controller built into my old Asus motherboard, or my current Asus motherboard, means that these newer devices will work. You won't notice the difference so much on a regular spinning hard drive, but if you have an external SSD, you will definitely notice more performance.
Nice.
Although one wonders why you have an external SSD.
Well, there's that. Yeah. Well, I don't know. That's a good question.
Well, it depends what you're using it for. I know at the college now, students are required to buy an external hard drive to carry virtual machine images around for their classes.
Could be great for that.
If that was an SSD, you would have problems with the storage space because you probably want at least a couple hundred gigs. But the improved speed you would get there might be useful.
Well, and you know, there's a range of external Thunderbolt drives that are SSD. But Thunderbolt's, 10 gigabit connections, so that makes a lot of sense. While we were talking about this, Dersani in the chat room, sorry, Dersani, if I'm butchering your name, he passed along a link from ZDNet, and ZDNet says that the malware, back to the last story, the malware arrives via a Java applet called adobe.jar.adobeflashplayer.jar, or, I know, right? That's a good one. Or another method entirely, like through social networking. So it actually sounds like maybe the actual attack vector isn't clearly defined, but one that has been discovered is as adobe.jar and adobeflash.jar player.
That's funny, to make a Java exploit that pretends to be a Flash exploit.
Right. It's kind of like they're just, they're smiling when they come up with that one. So thanks. There's a little instant update right there in the in the show.
Asus makes faster USB devices, and if you buy them now, they have a backwards compatible thing to work with your existing USB controller until you buy a new Asus motherboard.
This sounds silly, but I'd like to see this is installed on like Android phones. So that way when you're copying files to an Android device, it could be a little faster, that kind of stuff. That'd be cool.
I think your speed limit there is mostly the processor and the whatever kind of flash memory they use inside the phone. Interesting update. My phone got Jelly Bean yesterday.
Yeah, how do you like it?
Going from gingerbread to
jelly beans, big
ice cream. No, I went from gingerbread to ice cream sandwich on Monday.
Oh, okay.
So I got that update on Monday, and that was a big change. All the buttons are different.
Yeah,
like how you answer the phone is different. Before you to answer the phone, you swiped a little green icon from the left to the center of the screen.
Okay, yeah.
And to reject the call, it was from the right to the center of the screen.
Yeah.
Now there's a button in the middle, and you swipe from the middle to the right to answer, and the middle to the left to hang up. And they moved the OK button in the unlock pin screen.
Yeah.
So after you type in your passcode, the OK button's in a different place.
So all of your little
really
muscle memory.
Your muscle memory. Yeah.
That would screw me up.
You get an extra row of everything in your home screen, which is nice.
Yes.
And all the icons are blue instead of green.
Okay.
But that was a big change.
How did you notice any performance differences between gingerbread and ice cream?
I haven't done that much with it yet.
Okay. Okay.
I don't like the layout of the text messages quite as much as I did on the old one, actually. But basically, I got ice cream sandwich on Monday and then upgraded to jelly bean on Wednesday. Okay. I kind of pushed the updates back to back.
Yeah.
So between ICS and jelly bean, I didn't really notice
too much.
There weren't any differences I could see compared to the.
Does your 2.3. phone feel faster than it did a couple of weeks ago or a week ago?
Well,
or?
I use it for text messaging, phone calls. It doesn't ever feel slow.
Okay. All right. I'm curious to also know about your battery life, because I know when I went to Gingerbread, I got a big improvement. I'd be curious to know if
my battery life has been very good, so I don't know. It's a Google Nexus S.
I'm very curious to know how Project Butter turns out, because one of the things that does great on me over time is sort of the UI stuttering and things like that, because it seems so critical on a touchscreen that the UI be extremely responsive. So I think if Project Butter really has improved kind of that responsiveness, that could be a huge win for Android. Yep. Well, cool. So I don't know. Let us keep us updated if something interesting crops up when you're using it.
Cool.
Should we talk about this Black Hat story where they explained the fake passwords and the reset email that was sent out?
Yeah.
All right. Tell me about it.
So the Black Hat conference, which is coming up, I don't know the date, but 7,500 of the attendees got a password reset email that they weren't expecting. And there was some concern it was a phishing attack or that their database was compromised or something. But as it turns out, it appears that a volunteer working for ITN International, which is the company that handles the on-site registration and check-in for the Black Hat conferences, accidentally sent out the password reset template.
Just funny, since the crowd that's attending to this, I find it kind of amusing. Yep. So it wasn't a phishing. So if they went and changed their password, they changed their legitimate password.
Well, they couldn't, because the URL linked in the emails was a unqualified domain name that only works inside the Black Hat registration network. So only when you're registering and you're on one of their Wi-Fi does this address even exist.
Oh, right? Okay.
It doesn't end at .com. It's an unqualified domain name. It's just like, you know, I forget what the URL is, but it's just a URL with no dots in it. Right? So it doesn't work outside of there anyway.
Yeah.
Hmm. So the emails include the username and a new password in plain text. Instead of that, it probably should direct users to a password reset page where you ask the user some bit of information the database might also have.
In plain text.
To at least pretend to... Well, it has to be in plain text, right? If you're resetting someone's password, you have to give them the new password in plain text. Otherwise, how they use it.
Right.
But what better sites will do is instead give you a link, you go to that link, you answer some secret question or something, mm-hmm. and then you just type in a new password and they never have a temporary password that is printed in plain text anywhere.
That makes sense. I mean, that seems the way to do it.
This is a conference management system run by ITN, not the Black Hat conference. So you don't expect quite that.
It's still, though,
sensitive information in there. But,
no, it's no big deal.
But yes, the email includes a URL to sign into the Black Hat conference system, but that only works. It's an unqualified host name that would only work if you're on the Black Hat registration.
On their LAN.
With their DNS server.
Yeah.
But because of this, ZDNet may have, their tech writer may have jumped to some conclusions. And basically assumed that it was a very poor phishing attempt. Neglecting to consider how a phisher would have got all the email addresses of the attendees. Although in the updated version is like, Black Hat didn't get hacked and their email addresses weren't compromised. But in the original post, he never mentioned that that would be the only way that the phishers would have got the email
addresses of the attendees. Love it. Somebody got a little excited.
But he noted that it was a really bad phishing attempt because the URL was not even real, failing to recognize that it was specifically done like that on purpose.
Right.
So that it's not an internet accessible system.
That's actually kind of clever, because isn't it?
If you're the Black Hat conference, you would like to restrict people pounding on it to at least the people that paid to be there.
that shows you can see there are actually some clever people there.
But also that the from address hadn't been spoofed to look like it was from like blackhat.com.
Right.
And same with the URL that it sent, right? You know, with most phishing emails, at least the text that it looks like you're clicking on to go to the website will say, you know, blackhat.com or paypal.com rather than the real URL, which is like an IP address or a subdomain or something.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was making fun of the poor phishing attempt, not realizing that it wasn't a phishing attempt at all and that there was a reason it was done like that.
Well, you know, sometimes the bloggers get it wrong, Alan.
And blackhat.com has their explanation and apology, including a screenshot of how it happened.
Well, good for them. I mean, they've embraced it and explained it, and it's a good learning experience, isn't it?
Yes.
All right. Well, should we talk about our next story?
Sure.
every now and then, Alan, one of our own is wounded in the battle for your data online. Oh, man, I just need a jingle and some epic music, and that was actually pretty good. So last night on Google Plus, I saw Brian posted that his WordPress site got hacked. And he of course, immediately took to the web and posted on his blog over at lunduke.com about the issue. And the title was, Google Doesn't Want People to Know About Better Software. And here's where things kind of went off the rails, is Google has a series of tools that will identify if a site has malicious code on it and then start warning the users when they visit the site. Right. I think probably a lot of people have seen that.
Google Safe Browsing, and it's built into Firefox and Chrome.
Yeah. So
and basically,
people started getting that, right?
Yeah. As Google is out there spidering the internet, when it notices malware infections on a website, it will put it into its DNS blacklist, and then your browser checks that before it goes to every website.
Right.
And when it finds that URL is on a blacklist, it shows a giant warning page instead of the website so that you don't get infected.
And that happened to Brian.
Now,
on Brian, his RadicalBreeze.com site.
So when this happened to RadicalBreeze.com, which is Brian's official website for Illumination Software Creator, he wrongly and very mistakenly assumed that Google had decided that Illumination Software Creator was malware.
But oh, is that what it was? Okay.
Yes. So that's what he meant by their subject, that he doesn't want people to have better software. They're like, in his blog post, you can see his rant. He's talking about how Google is trying to block ISC because Google has randomly decided it's evil or something.
And I think what kind of happened though is the Google Webmaster Tools kind of failed him because the Google Webmaster report came back as clean, and he has screenshots of it here on his blog.
Well, it's just that it's slow to update.
Oh, right. You know,
Google's very big, and they spider a lot of websites at once, and so it takes a little while for data to converge.
That happened. So I had Bin False, my old blog that I used to keep up to date, was a WordPress site, and it got an iframe injection, and the Webmaster Tools didn't identify it. Same thing. Webmaster Tools took a day or two to get the update, but the Google Index, when it finds it, it puts it in the block like right away.
Well, it's because it's trying to prevent these infections.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway. Brian assumed that Google was trying to block Illumination Software Creator. Apparently, he's never seen one of these malware notices and doesn't realize that no one at Google actually reads your website and decides this website is eventually links for you to buy some software that we decide is evil. Rather, it was that there was actually malicious code on every page of his website.
Yeah.
So in this case, the compromise was entirely Brian's fault for using incredibly old versions of WordPress and Plesk.
Oh, is that what it was? Oh, okay. See, that's...
So Brian's RadicalBreeze.com runs WordPress version 2.9.1. The current version of WordPress is 3.4.1. He's way behind.
You know what? That is an issue because I also sometimes sort of have like update anxiety with WordPress because it has broken in the past.
Yes. Well, your site's a lot bigger than Brian's is as well, though.
That's true. There's a lot of plugins and things like that. But the other thing that I have is like hosted on Scale Engine. If something got really wonky, like some sort of database error or something like that, I would just contact you, like, Alan, oh my God, help! But see, he's hosting that on a Pier 1 server, just a Linux box that he has to run on his own. That, you know, if there's a FTP server compromise or if there's something like that, that's all on him to have to fix, and it kind of becomes like this.
In this case, it seems that this particular malware that infected his site is related to vulnerabilities in Plesk, which is a web hosting control panel that you install on a dedicated server to make it easier to manage.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There was a zero-day exploit for Plesk announced about 3 weeks ago.
We covered it then, yeah.
Yeah. And basically...
Brian's just got to watch more TechSnap because we talked about this 3 weeks ago.
A fix for the vulnerability in Plesk has been out since February.
Well, there you go.
And there was an extra advisory about it in July when a lot of these sites started being hacked. And that's what allowed the automated script to compromise his website and inject this iframe that would cause it would rotate through different malware, but most of the time it would use a flash exploit to attempt to infect people's computers with the drive-by download.
Mm.
Mm. And, you know,
they could
have been using that OS X crisis malware and been infecting Mac users as well.
I still kind of feel for him, though, because it does kind of suck that Google can start blocking your site before they give you the tools to take any action and identify what the issue is. So there is kind of like a... Now, that said, I should mention the TechSnap community, however, was really rocking this right away. you can see the comments on Brian's blog, but also we had a post here from a Pears in the TechSNAP subreddit, and he busted out Firebug in Firefox, and he found the iframe here. And there's a good conversation that went on.
A simple view source on the page would have shown the malicious code with a really long Polish URL in it.
Well, very true. Very true. But I liked the screenshot action and stuff, the community. Once Brian put the call out, people really kind of got together to help him figure out where it was at.
Because Brian was trying to generate rage against Google when it really wasn't Google's fault that his website got hacked.
Well, that's true. But one does generate better clicks. I'll give you that.
Yeah.
Now, of course, you know, Alan, this would be a good stop to take a pause and say...
Well,
you...
we're not quite done. Almost
oh, we're
done.
Not? All right.
So it's unclear if any customer data from Radical Breeze was compromised. It's likely possible that it could have been, but because this was an automated attack that literally just scans the internet for vulnerable Plesk or WordPress blogs and injects this iframe, that there was actually no person on the other end of this, just some robots, so that they wouldn't know to look for the database and try to steal customers or whoever, you know, payment information from people who paid for Illumination Software Creator. Then I have a link to the Google Safe Browsing report, which specifically says that malicious software on radicalbreeze.com is hosted by dynapass.ru, which is a Russian site, and one domain appears to be functioning as an intermediary for distributing malware visitors, including sqqkemzgshwnkkrk.waw.pl.
Wow, there you go.
Which is actually what this malware does is generate a random URL every 12 hours based on a random number generator.
Yeah.
And uses so that the URL that Google tries to have in their blacklist changes every 12 hours.
That's clever. That's clever. Hmm. So eventually.
Basically, on that page that Brian shows a screenshot of, where when they block a website, they say specifically in a giant section in big bold letters labeled "How did this happen?" Google's explanation says, "In some cases, third parties can add malicious code to legitimate sites, which will cause us to show this warning message." If Ryan had read that, he might not have assumed that Google was trying to stop people from buying Illumination Software Creator rather than dealing with the fact that he had spyware on his blog.
Now, poor Brian, too, because he's in the process of moving everything that was, I'm not positive, but I think he's moving stuff from radicalbreeze.com to his lunduke.com, so he just has one server to manage.
Yep.
You know, because this is exactly the problem is when you put this stuff out there, you got to stay on top of it. WordPress
2.9.1. It's just quite old.
Yeah. The downside, I love WordPress, used it for years and years. But the downside is the reality is even though it's risky to update WordPress, it's more risky to leave it unpatched because there's so many automated tools. You don't even have to have a very big
it's
website.
It's mostly just because WordPress is so popular that it's a huge target.
I mean, my BenFalse blog got 500 visitors maybe a week, 600 visitors by the time. Because, I mean, I had stopped using that blog for a couple of years and then just some automated scanner had found it. So it doesn't even have to be a very popular web page. You just have to keep it up to date.
A lot of these bots, what they do is they Google for the version string of a known vulnerable version of WordPress.
And it's embarrassing, like, as a company, to have your customers see that, because it, especially if you're selling something.
This links back to that story we talked about a little while ago, where the study came out and said that religious websites are more likely to infect your computer than porn websites. And it's because people that run websites for churches and stuff set up WordPress and then forget about it.
Yeah.
And then this exact type of thing happens, and then people go to the website of the local church and they get a virus. Whereas, you know, websites run by porn companies that are trying to make money and sell you stuff have a vested interest in keeping those things up to date and secure because they're a target for hackers.
Exactly.
And they don't want their credit card database being stolen.
Very well put. Any other thoughts on that one?
Nope.
Okay. Now, this would be a good time to mention GoDaddy.com, the sponsors of this week's episode, because honestly, one of the things I love about GoDaddy is they have a very easy-to-use web management system. You go in there, and it says, by the way, you need to update your WordPress. Would you like us to do that? And you press a single button, and it updates WordPress, and it'll update all of the plugins on your WordPress from their central control panel. Now, of course, Brian uses this for Lunduke.com, and he hasn't had an issue there, but where he's off on his own little island with RadicalBreeze.com, the issue comes up. And this is the same issue I ran into, and this is why I love this kind of stuff. But now, look, before you host...
Because the other thing is that the GoDaddy then manages things like Plesk or the control panel for you. Whereas when you have your own server, you're responsible for doing that. And when you fail to do that, you run into this problem.
That is so true. Because those control panels are such a vulnerable attack surface that you have to stay on top.
Because those control panels have to have administrative access in order to create new users and reset users' passwords. Right. It means if you do compromise them, then you have root access, basically.
This is why I like the GoDaddy system, because this is their business, and they keep this current and they keep this stuff secure.
Right. They have a staff of net admins whose job it is to do this stuff for you.
Literally, yeah, that's what all they do. Now, before you get a hosting over there, though, you're probably going to want to get a .com, and we only have a limited time left on this special offer to get a .com for $4.95, and this will be even yearly. So, I mean, when it renews, it's still $4.95 for up to 3 domains. You just have to use our code 495TECH when you check out. 495TECH, and that is done at the end of July. So Tuesday, after this episode comes out, that code's all done. Yep. So go use it while it still lasts. 495TECH to get a .com domain for $4.95. And then if you want to get more than three, you can get them for $7.99. So it's still actually an incredible deal if you're getting more than three domains. So if you've been thinking about pulling the trigger, do it now. And I'm talking to you, Alan, because I know you've been waiting to pull the trigger. So go take advantage of that.
I had to think of some domains, but now I just have to go buy them.
I know. It's like you know, I have had a couple ideas floating around, and this thing expires at the end of the month. This is a really good one. I'm going to go grab them, and I honestly do that all the time. So thank you to GoDaddy for sponsoring this week's episode of TechSnap. All right, Alan, with all of the news done, let's get into the TechSnap feedback. Thanks for sending your emails to techsnap@jupiterbroadcasting.com or using the contact us form at the top of the website. That's become a very popular one. Or, like our first question, Alan, this one was submitted to our subreddit over at links.techsnap.tv. And I'll be honest, I'm particularly biased to that method because it lets the other members in the community chime in. Are you ready for the first question?
Yep.
All right, now don't be too surprised, Alan. I managed to somehow sneak in another pfSense question. Mm-hmm. I'm currently testing pfSense as a load balancer. And by the way, this comes from Chumako. So I'll start over because I got all crazy. I'm currently testing the pfSense as a load balancer for some Nginx and Ruby on Rails servers. I would eventually like it to be used to balance database servers as well. I was wondering how the built-in load balancer compares to things like HAProxy. I noticed the built-in option has TCP or DNS options for the relay protocol, but I'm not sure for this case which would be better. If you guys had time to do a quick run-through on setting up a load-balanced environment properly, that would be great. I have my setup working, but I think it could be better. Use aliases, for example, appropriate firewall rules, etc., etc. Thanks for answering my past questions. Well, you bet, dude. You've always got great questions. So what do you think, Alan? Have you used pfSense much as a load balancer?
Not as a load balancer. Depending on what you're doing, sometimes an application-level load balancer is better. For example, if you're trying to balance the load between web servers, Nginx itself is the best load balancer. It has more configurability for saying, if a server fails, don't use that server and use the rest in the pool until it's been this many seconds since the last failure. Or don't try this one again for this long. Hmm. And it much more fine-grained configuration. Also, Nginx allows you to do unfair load balancing where you assign each server a weight and the traffic gets distributed unfairly, right? Because in the load balancer, you don't always want fair load balancing, right? If you have three servers in your back end and one of them has more RAM or a bigger processor, you want more of the work to go to it.
Right. I love that.
Or if one of the three is running some other workload that keeps it fairly busy, you want less load to go to that one.
Hmm. That's a very good point.
Yeah. So sometimes a more intelligent load balancer higher up the stack will be doing a better job than just doing, you know, TCP load balancing or CARP or something right at the IP level.
And so your recommendation would be some sort of low profile FreeBSD box sitting there doing
well,
that.
Well, you
kind
can
of
install
logic?
I'm pretty sure you could install Nginx on the pfSense box and use it to rev the traffic.
Perfect. Perfect. That'd be ideal.
Yeah.
Yeah, or, that's a great way to reuse that box, cuz then you still have your traffic go through that point.
So I prefer Nginx over something like HAProxy. Which is the high availability proxy. It doesn't quite have as many options and it doesn't understand the protocol quite as much. The other thing with Nginx is you can, because it understands HTTP, you can make the decision based on other things. Mm. Like you can say, I'm going to load balance the traffic for this part of the website to these servers, But the like images subdirectory, I'm going to put all the load on this one server with a failover to a second server.
Right. Or I have, you know, all my images are stored on the server with the SSD drive, so we want everything to just pop when it loads from that. That's
right.
That's really cool.
You can do a lot more with it.
So you can actually do component, like you can break out the areas of your website.
You define the different paths or use a regular expression to say, you know, any path that ends in .php, you have to do this with it.
And to do that, you would use
Nginx? Yeah. So Nginx is a much better HTTP load balancer. And then, you know, if you have two of them with identical configs, then you do your carp on the IP address that the traffic is coming in on, and then you have your high availability there as well.
Where would be a good spot for him to kind of... I mean, he obviously has worked with Nginx a bit, so...
So basically, you might want to just put an extra Nginx on the pfSense box and have it load balance between your existing Nginx servers, rather than just using some kind of TCP load balancer that doesn't understand HTTP.
Gotcha.
The other advantage to that is you can do SSL offloading. You can have all the SSL encryption take place on the load balancer if it has a big enough CPU and leave all that off of the backend servers.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you have a lot of SSL, it means you could actually split it up and have the SSL happen on the backend, but that's more complicated.
Yeah, but gives you a lot of flexibility. Yeah. And also, especially if you start with Nginx.
You can have the gzip. If you're compressing like your CSS output or your JavaScript, you can have that happen on the load balancing Nginx rather than on the nodes that are generating that code and are already busy and CPU bound.
Right.
Although you can also have Nginx serve pre-gzipped versions. Basically, it detects if the user's browser requested gzip or not and will just look for a static gzip version of the file on the file system.
Just ready to go.
Yeah. And then you avoid the extra CPU usage altogether.
Right. That's a great idea, actually. I mean, that just makes a ton of sense.
When you get to balancing databases, it can get rather complicated, especially because things like MySQL have their own protocol.
Yeah.
And depending on how you want to load balance it, it can get really complicated. Now, you can just, you know, have a bunch of IPs and load balance it randomly or whatever with a TCP-level load balancer.
Mm-hmm.
But you run into problems of, you know, if you are using master-master replication in that case. Otherwise, you need to divide the queries up based on what's a read query and what's a write query. And all the writes have to go to the master and the reads can go to a slave. But then even then, sometimes you need if you've just written something, like if you're doing the comment section on a blog, if you write to the master and then read from a slave that's not caught up to the master, the person's comment won't be there yet.
Right.
And that can cause an issue. And so sometimes you have to read from the back end or the back end that you wrote to.
Right.
And that can be an issue with Nginx as well. Basically, if you're dividing up your Ruby or PHP load across five servers, if you're doing PHP sessions and you're not using Memcache or a database to store those, and you're storing them by default in /TMP, then that means that if you get load balanced, if the first page you visit goes to server A, and then you load a second page and you end up on server B, your session isn't there because that temporary data is not there.
Mm-hmm.
So Nginx has a mode called sticky, where basically once a user, it uses a hashing algorithm to assign users to a specific backend, and they'll only ever change if that backend goes down. And that way, then they would get logged out and have to relog in. But most of the time, they would hit the same backend over and over again. That way, that user always has their session data is still there.
Huh. Now,
so it gets really complicated when you try to load balance a database.
Do you think that for the database thing, that's going to be very sort of, so I guess what you're saying is
there's a special load balancing proxy for MySQL, but it's not great. The part of the issue there is SQL protocol does the login part before the query. So if you log in, right, and your first query you do is an update, it connects you to the master and runs the update. Then on the same connection, you run a select query, which is a read-only query. Then you would normally want that to run on one of the slaves that's read-only. But you're not logged into that slave. You're in a logged-in session routed to the right master.
And
reverse can happen, right? The first query you do is read-only. You connect to a read-only slave, and then you try to write to it, and you have a problem. So then the MySQL proxy basically has to store your authentication, your password in plain text, and re-log you in on a second server in the middle of a session.
Okay.
And there's all kinds of issues with it.
Yeah.
And basically, there are people working on it and trying to make something out of it, but they haven't really come up with an elegant solution.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, and that's why usually what you'll see is some kind of sharding, where different components of the website will be broken out into be in different parts, different databases. So basically, you'd have your WordPress with your posts over here, and your comments would be in a separate database server, and you'd split the load that way instead. And then you can use federation to make it so that when you write it, certain tables exist on a different server, but each server sees all the tables.
That sounds complicated, especially depending on what the kind of database work he's doing.
Yeah. And basically, when you get to that scale, it's a lot better if you've designed your app with this in mind ahead of time.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, have a separate database connection with separate calls for when you're doing read-only stuff. So basically, you know, you say this query has to always run on a master because it's write. This query always has to run on a master because it's reading something we just wrote. Whereas this query is reading something that's been in the database for a while. It doesn't matter if it's 5 seconds out of date. This can always go to a slave.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, but writing your application like that is a lot of extra work.
Mm-hmm.
And people generally don't do that until their website's already too big. And then, you know, it's a chicken and egg problem.
If anybody else has some thoughts on this, I will link in the feedback section of the show notes. Alan and I always put the links to the questions in there. And this week, this particular one links to the subreddit thread. So if you want to throw your ideas in there for Chimoko, you can do that.
It's Kokomo.
Yeah. I got a thing I'm known for. It's not a great thing, but I got a thing I'm known for, and that's messing up words, Alan. Come on. All right, you ready for the next email? See if maybe I can mess up a few words.
Somebody in the chat room was asking about partitioning. Partitioning in MySQL doesn't split it up between servers. It just breaks the table up into separate tables based on some hashing algorithm so that the indexes are smaller. It makes it faster to search a very large database or to do inserts and selects from a large database, but it won't actually provide any load balancing.
Gotcha. That was a pretty interesting discussion. I mean, I didn't really think we'd go down that route, but I like it, sir. All right, you ready for the next question? Comes from Jason Allen, and he wants us to put a universal debate finally to rest right here on the show. And it goes as such. Prepare yourselves, because we are going to declare it here on the show. This will be put to rest. Jason writes, here's a question that I've had for some time. I keep getting different answers. Can you put this to bed? To defrag or not to defrag? Is it still important to defrag virtual servers? What about RAID disks? Please explain once and for all why or why not. Thanks for the great show. What do you think, Alan? What's your opinion on defragging?
It depends. If you have an SSD, you don't want to defrag. Basically, all the extra reading and writing will just wear out the disk faster. And since there's no penalty for seeking to different areas of the disk, you're not really gaining anything by defragging.
Right.
On my regular spinning hard drives, I defrag, but not the way normal people do. I use, on my Windows machine here, I use a utility from Mark Rusinovich called Contig, as in contiguous, and you can defragment individual files or directories.
Oh, neat.
So, for example, after Star Wars or Star Trek patches itself, because they're changing the middle of a really big file, it basically fragments the file really badly. And since you're trying to read that file every time you load something in the game, it slows you down.
Yeah.
So I can defragment individual files without doing my whole hard drive. So it's kind of a trade-off there. But
it doesn't say it supports Windows 7. Am I looking at the wrong one? Have you still been able to use it on Windows 7?
Yeah, it works fine on Windows 7.
Okay,
It uses the defrag API that the Windows defrag utility does. It just lets you specify individual files rather than the whole drive.
Then you know it's safe. So yeah. I like that. Okay, so I would also tend to agree. I would say on an NTFS volume, you should stay on top of it for sure, because one of the problems with NTFS, and excuse me while I add a link to Contig in the show notes here, one of the problems with NTFS is that it can get to a point where there's no return, you know, much like extended 2 and 3 can. Now, I do try to stay on top of those, but honestly, like on the Mac file system, which is just HFS Plus is one of the greatest travesties of our current computer generation, and nobody's talking about how awful it is. And it has serious issues that can happen with fragmentation, so much so that OS X has built in now that it automatically, in real time, defragments files. Anything that's less than 20 megabytes, the Mac file system does sort of like a contig thing as it writes to the file system. Now on Linux,
On FreeBSD, there's a different approach. The UFS file system allocates files in cylinder groups, and it won't let it won't fill up the cylinder group all the way, so that it leaves slack for files to grow into, to prevent fragmentation.
Right, right, and so it is sort of file system dependent, but a great example of systems that I had to be very religious about defragging, and I would very much be able to chart the performance impact, was on Windows 2003, and I would assume it'd be the same for later versions of Windows, terminal services, where you'd have 20, 25 users using a single system. I mean, think about that. Think about a computer that gets used by a single employee, right?
Yeah, so every bit of seeking that's happening is happening a lot more. And
yeah,
so,
yeah, all the temp files, all the profiles.
An app I've used before is called O&O Defrag. I think it's German. And it allows you to defragment based on different criteria. For example, you could defragment your hard drive based on the last modified date of the file.
Oh, awesome.
So files that haven't changed get moved to the front of the drive, and all the files that do change are at the end, so that they have all the free space around them to grow into. And the files that never change sit up in the other area. Or if you're most after performance, you can defrag by last access time, putting the files accessed the most often at the front of the drive, which is the fastest.
I have also had some success on the terminal servers using, can't remember the name, who's the folks that make the CCleaner software that goes through and like deletes a bunch of stuff on a Windows box? Anyways, they also make a tool called like Smart Defrag. And what's nice about Smart Defrag is I could say, I want you to run all Sunday long. And if you're not done by Monday at 6 a.m., go ahead and stop and then resume later in the evening and finish that job, say starting at 8 p.m. or whatever it was. And that was really nice because it just, like, when I knew the servers, the terminal servers weren't being used by users, I'd just say, go whole hog. And then,
The O&O also had a mode called passive defrag, where it would just try to defragment individual files, but not the free space. So it wouldn't scan and analyze the whole disk and figure out a strategy and sort the files. It would just scan each file and be like, oh, this one's in fragments, let's defragment that one. And so it was a lot less resource intensive. And it had a scheduling thing as well.
So yeah, it was. They have a pair in their logo or something like that. That's why I was getting it messed up. It's So I'll put a link to Defragler too in the in the show notes. Well, that was interesting. So there you go.
And now there's some other questions here specifically about virtual machines. If you're using virtual machines, especially if you're using disk images rather than something like iSCSI, you can have issues there. First one is if you're using something that has like snapshots or any other copy on write, you can get huge fragmentation because it means every time something changes, you don't update. So if a file is a nice contiguous block and you change the middle in a copy on write, you would move the part in the middle you changed would end up being written somewhere else. And next time you try to read that file, zit, jump, and then back, right? Yeah. Because you need to have the old version and the new version. And so it can cause a lot of fragmentation.
And thanks to Mixstep in the chat room, we'll also have a link to information on defragmenting extended 3 file systems using a couple of different commands. So I'd say both of us say yes, depending on, of course, a blanket no if it's an SSD drive. Alan, ZFS, is there a big difference here with fragmentation? Is that really an issue?
With ZFS, again, you have that copy on write, and so it can be an issue.
Oh, okay. That is ZFS. Oh, okay.
Well, no, but virtual servers use the same idea for snapshots and so on. Any system snapshots will have the same copy on write thing.
Yeah.
ZFS was supposed to get a defragmentation utility based on block pointer rewriting, but it was something that died when Oracle took over. So it's interesting to see what happens there. With ZFS, is not really that big of a deal because it knows about all this stuff because the hardware layer and the file system layer are so ingrained together in ZFS, it can make decisions about that a little better. But where it came in ZFS was trying to keep each disk with the same amount of free space or to even fill the drives. Because in ZFS, your write speed goes down if one of your hard drives gets full. Because in the array of my home file server, not all my disks are the same size.
That's nice.
So when one of them fills up, now no due data gets written to that one, so my write speed goes down.
That's the downside.
Five writes between the other disks.
Yeah.
And so there's supposed to be a command that would actually even it out for you. by moving blocks and leveling out the hard drives, but that never got built. You can still do it manually. You can still do it manually by moving files off and then moving them back on, and then they would get the BIOS system would kick in and put less of the data on the fuller drive.
Oh, okay.
But you know that takes it's a lot of work to copy the same file back and forth a bunch of times just to level out the free space.
Drobo has sort of a similar issue where when you do the mismatched drives, which is nice because then you can just take spare drives from around your house and put them in an array, but when one drive fills, it cuts down on the write performance. Now, what's interesting is Mr. Mango in the IRC chat room says he's got a Windows box, 4 years old, and it's a 0% fragmentation. So now, I am talking about servers, by the way.
Yeah, but your Windows desktop, the reason it says 0% fragmentation is that Windows 7 by default will run a defrag.
He says auto schedules off.
Well, then it's basically if you've ever installed a Windows update, your fragmentation level is going to be higher than 0%.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to say. It's his readout's probably wrong. Yeah. And the problem is
a lot of it's still on and he didn't notice.
A lot of those tools. Now, you know what though? The background on a 4-year-old system, the background defragger won't get it down to 0%. It won't get it down to zero. Maybe 1 or 2%. But the problem is, and this is an issue with Windows, is a lot of the tools, like you mentioned, hook into that API. So if that is reading something wrong, and that does happen, a lot of the programs that sit on top of that also are just getting the same bad information. I would say, though, for me at least, I repave a desktop at least minimum once a year because I'm usually trying some Linux distro and I blow something up and I have to reinstall all my OSs. So I never really bother with defragging my desktop personally. I don't ever really find it to be necessary. Now, these systems out here in the garage are a couple of years old now. Maybe I should actually look at these. You know, maybe I'll check it during the break. I'll check this install right here and we'll see what its fragmentation level is. But all right, Alan, are you ready for our last question this week? It's actually not so much a question as it is a follow-up to last week's question. Remember when we had somebody write in that wanted to come up with a new solution to getting internet access when he's out on his boat? Yeah, I know. Do you want me to go back? I was just skipping it for time.
Okay.
But
we'll do it next week.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. We'll do it next week because it's kind of a long one. It's for Simon, and he wants to know what's involved with dedicating and administrating a dedicated server. We kind of covered that
probably
earlier.
Probably be a good one for Brian.
I was going to say, we kind of covered that earlier with Brian. But we'll maybe give that some thought and we'll answer.
Yeah, maybe I'll actually make that more of a main story next week.
Yeah, there you go. All right, that could be a little interesting segment. So, all right, so we'll do our last one from Mike. So he's following up on the internet access on a boat, and he said, what about some sort of mesh networking? Although it would require participation from a large number of vessels, basically wireless nodes could be deployed near shore and then connected to the internet, and then vessels carrying the repeater nodes would allow vessel operators to use the network but also share it with other repeater nodes. They say here, oh, by the way, there's an update available for my software. That's handy.
The issue with that kind of mesh networking is the range is, you know, unless you have boats that have line of sight to each other and are really close together in a long string, then your mesh isn't going to work. Because the points are moving all the time, it's really hard to maintain a mesh.
Yeah, and it would be...
basically, you know, once you get out into the ocean, how are you going to have a link back to the rest of the internet? Sure, you could have a mesh where you could talk to all the other boats near you, but
that could almost be interesting. But yeah, exactly. and you got to figure the guy the furthest out in that mesh link is going to have some crappy service, right? Because he's got to go, and that other boats between them would be changing positions. I love the idea though.
Because you're out in international waters at some point, you might be able to avoid regulations as far as the power you can output.
Interesting.
But basically, the most power you're allowed to output from your home Wi-Fi thing is 4 watts, which won't get you very far. Now, you know, even if you're just getting out to, what's it like, the 20-mile limit where the U.S. laws apply in the water, you would need more than 4 watts to get from shore to that far.
Yeah, you'd have to be able to up it for sure. You probably wouldn't use Wi-Fi. In fact, he kind of goes on to talk about a couple of different few mesh protocols, and the chat room already picked up on one of them, like the Batman protocol and things like that. And it would also, like he mentions, require that vessels work in cooperation in a way they don't now, and it could be expensive, but you never know. Maybe it's something down the road because...
Yep. And it would just require a lot of power, and since
it does
vessels
seem like...
have to generate their own power, usually from diesel fuel, they don't want to be... burning up. Now, usually they have a very large turbine that's, you know, powering the ship and they can just leech that as extra electrical power, but...
Yeah. Yeah, I guess really, I mean, the solution for getting internet in places that are that isolated really seems like it's got to just be improvements to satellite technology, which right now are partially just suffered from the distance that the signal has to travel.
And, the fact that launching a new satellite is very expensive.
Very expensive, yeah. Those are a couple of things. So, all right.
A lot of them to cover a large area. It's somebody in the chat room points out, a lot of these problems are easier to solve on land, and we haven't solved them there yet.
It's very true, unfortunately. Now, we do have, obviously we're holding the feedback. We'll keep that for next week. Sorry, Simon, but tune in next week to catch that. And it also gives you a chance to send in your emails, especially related to dedicated servers. If you've had challenges with dedicated servers, running one now and have great advice, anything like that, or anything we talked about early in the show that struck a note with you, send those in and we'll take a look at those.
51 dedicated servers in 21 data centers in 7 countries for a living. So
You might have a few thoughts. I've run a few servers myself, it turns out. So that should be interesting. Yeah. So if you have anything like that, send it into TechSNAP@JupiterBroadcasting.com or submit it to the subreddit. And we'll be sure to get to it on next week's episode. All right, Alan. Well, that means the feedback's all done. So it's time for the TechSNAP Roundup. And welcome to the TechSnap Roundup. Yeah, that's what that crazy music means. Now, the Roundup is full of stories that didn't quite make it to the top of the show. A lot of them were submitted via our TechSnap subreddit at links.techsnap.tv. And a lot of the times, we just want to give you the link so you can do a little extra reading on your own after the show. All right, Alan, the first story in the Roundup goes to me, and it's a follow-up to Skype. It's something that's kind of been bubbling up on the net for a while. People have been questioning what kind of monitoring Skype can do, and so some journalists actually tried to contact Skype, now Microsoft, and get an actual official answer. Microsoft responded with, "As was true before Microsoft's acquisition of Skype, we cooperate with law enforcement agencies as is legally required and technically feasible." Now, that's a little vague on what it means, but if you actually just look...
Now, the important thing is that technically feasible part. In the original design of the Skype network, where supernodes were random other users with good uptime... that Skype would route calls between, specifically.
Yeah, supernodes.
They would use them to store the directory service as far as who's online and who's available, and to route connections between people that are both behind NAT and can't directly connect to each other. Now, Chris and I make sure that we always have a direct connection because we get better video that way, because the connections routed through a supernode are bandwidth limited and wouldn't be able to do the HD video. But a lot of other people. And now, to improve the service, Skype has replaced most supernodes with dedicated servers running Linux that are controlled by Microsoft.
Which kind of centralizes it in some capacity.
Yeah, and it means that it's less likely that a call routed through a supernode is going to drop because the supernode goes offline or whatever, and it's not going to keep eating up other people's bandwidth to route your call. The problem is it now becomes technically feasible for Microsoft to wiretap calls.
Hmm.
Since Microsoft also controls the client, they could say, if we get a warrant to wiretap username X, we could force all of username X's communications to be routed even if they normally would have a direct connection.
And to that end, Microsoft has submitted and been awarded a patent that details how to wiretap Skype and other VoIP technologies.
Yeah. So the other concerning bit of news that fits hand in hand with this is that Microsoft has a patent on wiretapping Skype-like services.
Yeah. So they're centralizing the way the node infrastructure works and...
Then basically they could force your calls to go through the node, and that which case they would wiretap.
And they do say in their EULA, they say they are monitoring and the content of instant messages communications. Mm-hmm. And they also, which I think is interesting. Now here's where law enforcement could find this interesting. Location information derived from mobile carrier or other mobile device that you use. In connection with Quick products, when you control when your location is shared with others, your location is displayed and shared with the Quick users in accordance to our privacy settings. And it also denotes information about device identifiers derived from your device. And this could be on a desktop or a mobile device. When you log in...
So that would mean they could prove that it was your cell phone that logged into Skype.
Or your computer at your house. Because they'll also do desktops. Yeah. And they record that. So Skype is not the haven that it used to be for criminal activities. We have a link to that U.S. patent trademark application if you really want to read that. All right. Now, this next story in the Roundup is sort of like the final solution to being able to remember a password but never have to give it up under interrogation. It's like the ultimate password protection because you can store it in your brain subconsciously.
Yes.
Right?
So this is a technique for training your subconscious to remember a 30-character password. or the equivalent of a 30-character password.
Yeah, I was watching on Security Now. It sounded like that was a little ambiguous. It's more like six characters, right?
I don't know all the details, but basically, you train your brain using this video game, and then you use a version of that game to enter the password again in the future, rather than a regular password prompt. So it's not that you actually remember a 30-character string. It's that you just remember a pattern rather than a password.
Right.
Similar to, you know, the Google Android devices have like the swipe pattern. It's just longer than that. And basically, it kind of reminds me of the game Audio Surf, or even a modified version of like Guitar Hero, where it's just a pattern that you have to enter.
And it's sort of like this, so it's this sort of repetitive process that almost becomes like muscle memory in a sense?
Yeah, so you basically keep trying to match this process until you match it, and you can just keep doing that over and over again. Although it seems to run into the same problem that regular passwords use. If you use your password a lot, like every day, you don't forget it. It's the password that you haven't used for 6 months that suddenly you need to use it that you can't remember it.
Yeah, yeah. All right, ready for the next story?
And it seems this wouldn't really get you past that either.
Now let's talk about this next story, Alan, because we have a lot of people out there in the audience who've written in about TeamViewer, because it is a pretty handy remote administration tool. And TeamViewer, although it's pretty brief, HOnline has this urgent security update for TeamViewer. It's been posted, and this affects versions 5 to 7 of the Windows, Mac, and Linux editions of TeamViewer, full and quick. They're all affected, so you just need to do the update. Specifically, the flaw does not appear to have been discovered in the TeamViewer host application, though. The company hasn't really offered many details about their vulnerability, but all updates are available now at the TeamViewer website. This is an important one, folks, because it's something that listens remotely and accepts incoming connections. You need to make sure you patch it.
Usually has full admin access.
Yes.
And so basically, it sounds like they were given a vulnerability disclosure saying there's a problem here, and they're trying to get the fix out before the news about what the vulnerability actually is released. And so once this update's been out for a little while and people have had a chance to install it,
then we'll probably get
the full disclosure on it and find out what was compromisable and so on.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, let's talk about this next story because it's kind of funny if it's true. It comes from Russia Today, and they're basing it off of a blog post, so keep all of this in mind.
But the blog post is from the official F-Secure blog, which is an antivirus company in Finland.
Yeah,
now,
the
company in Finland says they can't verify the claims, but the email actually did come from the Iranian Nuclear Institute.
The email that got them started down this path. So this came from their chief researcher at F-Spot Secure, and he claims that Iranian nuclear program, their machines were hit with what they're dubbing the AC/DC virus. And no, Alan, that's not power. That's the rock band. They've actually had workstations that in the middle of the night would blare AC/DC.
But basically, it appears that a Metasploit-derived exploit was used to compromise the VPN at Natanz, and to mess with the Siemens centrifuges and the computer systems in general.
Yeah, wow. So they've published the letter on his blog, and they've cautioned that there's no way for them to verify it. But if you could, you can go see the letter from the Iranian scientists that F-Secure got, and there you go. All right, this next story is just a quick one, but I thought it was an interesting change of the tides. I mean, this is brand new for Apple. We mentioned some of the different changes they're making with Mountain Lion and their signed apps. They're also, for the first time, going to do a presentation at Black Hat. Now, Apple has attended Black Hat, but they always go very secretively. But writing for Bloomberg, Jordan Robertson reports that many people know Apple for a lot of things, but they don't really know them for attending these things. On Thursday, the manager of Apple's platform security team is scheduled to give a presentation on key security technologies within iOS, the OS that runs on iPhones and iPads. I think that's interesting. I think that's really good because it shows that Apple might actually be starting to take a different approach to security. And maybe they're actually reaching out to the community to create some sort of decent way for people to communicate vulnerabilities to Apple. Because one of the number one critics I hear about people trying to submit information to Apple is there's sometimes it's like just talking to a brick wall about their vulnerabilities.
They don't seem to have a process in place to receive vulnerability disclosures.
Yeah, yeah. All right, Alan, the next roundup story goes to you.
Is basically a similar idea, but the General Alexander, who's the commander of U.S. Cyber Command and the director of the NSA, is the surprise guest for DEF CON 2012, which is another security conference coming up soon. And basically, he's going to be talking about
the desperate need for cybersecurity legislation, probably.
Well, no, actually, he's going to be trying to get more of the hacker community to cooperate with the government.
Oh, good, good. Try to get them gray hats, maybe helping them out a little bit, that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
that's good.
Basically, part of it seems it's going to be some recruiting.
The fact that it's happening while they're voting on cybersecurity legislation is probably completely coincidental, I would say. Yeah. All right. So the next story
the title of the presentation he's giving is Shared Values, Shared Responsibility.
Oh, okay.
So basically, he's trying to convince hackers that they have a responsibility to, you know, protect their country or whatever. But also, you know, they want to see the internet be used as a positive force and so on.
Well, that makes me feel good. I feel all touchy-feely from that. All right. Now, let's talk about this next story. It came from Slashdot. Well, at least they posted it. And this is interesting. It's basically an admission that the FISA court surveillance violated the Fourth Amendment. It's official. The government spying efforts exceeded the legal limits at least once. Now, remember, this started happening under the Bush administration, and they started actually monitoring general communications. And at the time, they supposedly had clearance from the FISA courts, which you would need in order to be able to do this. Now it looks like they've actually overreached with some of those FISA warrants granted. And so some of it goes back to 2008. Now it's still happening in the Obama administration as well. So yeah.
Yep.
Pretty awesome stuff.
You know, once you give the government power, it's really hard to take it away.
Yeah, it's funny how when they do a little checkup on it, oh, yeah, it turns out we did violate the rules. Oh, jeez. Mm-hmm. All right, next one, F-Secure, another report from F-Secure.
That's
the same one. Oh, this is with ACDC? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Just a different headline.
I have my own link, and apparently you slipped one in when I wasn't looking.
Oh, I probably did. I got one from, where did I get? Oh, yeah.
You got yours from Russia Today. I had one that was the actual F-Secure thing. I'll combine them. Anyway.
Right. Oh yeah. Okay. So the next story is I don't even know if I'm current on this story, but a leaked report details anti-piracy strategy. Now this is coming out of
the IFPI, which is the International Phonographic Institute. Basically, it's the international version of the IRIAA.
It's adorable. It's adorable. They're just great people.
Something like that.
Yeah. And they have inadvertently made it available on their own confidential internal report. And so there you go, which details the strategy against online piracy for the major recording labels across the globe. The document's 30 pages long. Talks about file sharing sites, torrents, cyber lockers, phishing attacks, expectations from internet service providers, exceptions from internet service providers, MP3 sites, and a lot more. The document is a global representation of the IFPI's problems, current and future threats, as the industry responds to them. So, by the way, a couple of the tactics outlined in that is shutting down music services, requiring file lockers to install filters or be shut down through DMCA provisions and things like that. Also, lobbying for DNS blocking legislation was part of their plan, a.k.a. SOPA. Pressuring ISPs into extra legality and forcing at their will, a.k.a. three strikes and you're outlawed, that's taking effect, although it's actually not a law. And providing training around the world built on real-world experiences. And changing people's
piracy.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing there is that rule requiring file locker sites like Dropbox and YouSendIt and so on and
Mega Upload
to filter the content before it's posted is actually anathema to the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which says the hosting providers have safe harbor. They're not responsible for what people upload. The copyright holders have to report it, use the proper process, and have it taken down. Not that it's YouTube's job to filter everything before people upload it.
And frankly, YouTube does a horrible job. YouTube constantly flags Jupiter Broadcasting stuff.
Horrible false positive stuff.
And so this is what we get. And it sucks because it is slowly being changed into this mass media-controlled internet. I mean, it used to be you could post anything anywhere. And I realize we have to find some sort of common ground and a compromise there, but it really feels like the pendulum is swinging much too far in the other direction, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Yep. So, Alan, anything else we want to cover in this week's episode?
Nope, that's about it.
All right, sir. Well, we should let people know that if they want to watch us live and join us in the awesome live chat room that we have, you can do that over at jblive.tv at 1 p.m. Pacific, which is
4 p.m. Eastern or 2000 UTC.
And also the audio stream is available at jblive.info. And then TechSNAP is usually posted for download on demand in several different formats and resolutions over at jupiterbroadcasting.com, typically 4 or 5 hours after we're live. It just kind of depends on when it all gets up there. So I encourage you to join us because it's great to get the feedback live while we do the show. And also, if you just, you know, if the timing doesn't work out, grab one of those RSS feeds and subscribe to the show. Hey, Alan, by the way, this was cool. Mm-hmm. TechSNAP was featured, it might still be featured in the iTunes Looks Great in HD section.
Ooh,
right, awesome. On their front page. Yeah, the TechSNAP getting some love. So,
about time.
You know, though, we could use, and every now and then I ask for this, we could use some folks that want to give us some more positive ratings, because it's been like since January since TechSNAP's gotten rated in iTunes, and that helps with discovery. So if you are an user, help us out.
Hopefully the getting featured get us some new people, and those new people can click on it.
I haven't seen any comments yet, though. That's kind of like, I was like, finally, because the thing about the comments is it's sort of how iTunes on the back end determines which podcast it features, is a mixture of downloads, ratings, and comments. We've got the downloads portion, but we don't get any ratings or comments because the majority of our audience is not iTunes user. You guys, I don't think it's just not your bag. But some of you out there are, and if you are, we really depend on you to go out there and rate and comment.
Yes, some of you have it, or, you know.
Yeah. You know a computer that has it.
Yes, you have someone that is like a friend or lives in your house and has...
I'm not saying I like it. It just helps the show get discovered by more people.
Yes, it's like, you know, your mom has iTunes for her iPod. Just vote.
And it really does help out. It's a weird thing, and it really enables discovery for the show. So thank you, everyone who does that and takes the time to go into iTunes. I know it can be a little brutal. All right, everyone. Well, thanks so much for tuning into this week's episode of TechSNAP. We'll see you right back here next week.